بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون. أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم إن الذين كفروا سواء عليهم أأنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون.
أحسن أحسن أحسن.
ختم الله على قلوبهم وعلى سمعهم وعلى أبصارهم غشاوة ولهم عذاب عظيم. ومن الناس من يقول آمنا بالله وباليوم الآخر وما هم صدق الله العلي العظيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. الفاتحة.
اللهم صل على محمد.
صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
For the sake of our dear brother, his health, his iman, and that of his families, please recite a second salawat.
اللهم صل على
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين. So continuing from last night, I'm going to Salah ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So continuing from last night, I'm just going to continue with explanation of a few verses of Surah Al-Luqman. For those of you who have been attending at Imam Ali Masjid, there are a few here who have been, you've already heard me go through some of these verses, so please be patient if you have to hear me a second time. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنْ يُشْكُرُ لِلَّهِ وَمَنْ يَشْكُرُ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ حَمِيدٌ وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانَ لِابْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِدُّهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. So last night we went over the first verse, which was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that He has granted Luqman hikmah, and we mentioned who Luqman was, that Luqman was a slave who had originated from Sudan. And we mentioned that hikmah, according to ulama, is the characteristic of being able to understand the link between events, how an event came to be, and where it will head. And this is a special knowledge that Allah grants to people. We have a narration that hikmah is inversely proportional to the sins, so that when one commits sins, their wisdom is decreased. And when one abstains from sins, their wisdom is increased. And we mentioned yesterday that Luqman had particular characteristics that granted him this special wisdom. He took care of his tongue. That means he didn't speak much. And according to Hadith, he was quiet more than he spoke. He was very careful with his words. He was very careful with trust, amana. If he promised something, he did it. He was very honest with the people. And he didn't delve into affairs that weren't for him. We went over the first verse, which was about thankfulness and kufr. The second verse is now addressing Luqman talking to his son. And he said, Allah mentions, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانَ لِإِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِذُّهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. So he said, Luqman said to his son, O my son, and he was giving him admonishment, advice. And he says, my son, don't associate anything with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, understand there's more than one type of shirk. I'm sure many of you are already aware of that. There is the great shirk, which somebody is physically associating another god with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are many other forms of hidden shirk. The first verse, Luqman talked about shukr, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and kufr, being the opposite of shukr. Ungratefulness being the opposite of thanking Allah. Now he's talking about shirk. The reality is that when someone is ungrateful, or they are not giving the thanks, the proper thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a type of hidden shirk. Because one is claiming authority for themselves and not giving it all to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let me paint a small example so you can understand better. And why Luqman is saying this type of shirk is لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ, a great, great dhulm, a great oppression on mankind and on oneself. Imagine somebody works very hard and they graduate from university and they become a doctor, for example, medical doctor. Can one claim that they did it themselves? Many of us, we jump to the conclusion, I worked so hard, I did it. It was me. I worked very hard and I deserve this. We don't stop and think, okay, how is it that I was able to even study? Where did these books come from that I'm studying? Did I make them or did they come from others? This university and institution I went to, where did it come from? my ability to go to the school, for example, and come back. Where did it come from? The food that fed me, that made me able to grow and nurtured me until I was able to reach this position. Where did it come from? Millions, infinite number of things had to come together for you to reach that stage, whatever that stage is. How can somebody think that it's from themselves and not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So here, this is what Luqman is talking about and what Allah is mentioning, that he gave thanks to Allah, and that the opposite of this type of thanks is kufr, and it is a type of shirk. So this is a type of shirk, a type of hidden shirk, that one elevates themselves to a level that they are essentially associating themselves with Allah without realizing it. And this is one of the things which will prevent you from elevating spiritually. And it has to be eradicated from our souls. صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
And now I would like to introduce tonight's guest lecturer, our dear brother Sheikh Ali Abu Talib. صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما In the name of Allah, the source of mercy to all of creation, the source of the mercy to the faithful congregation. Surely the Lord God, truth and the light, and the celestial beings who can only do right, send hallowed invocations and most blessed supplications on the earth's final prophet, God's roof to all nations. O you people of faith who hear and obey unto him. O you people of faith who hear and obey, send unto him greetings in God and his angels' most blessed way. O Allah, bless Muhammad's soul and rain down peace on his household. Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu
Akbar. MashaAllah. Good to be here. Alhamdulillah. This day, this is the seventh day of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah. Sixth day for me, seventh day for me. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, MashaAllah. And I had intended to speak about intentions because it's a very important thing, and I always like to deal with the most basic things because the basics are the things that hold us up. But because of the events that happened in Orlando, I wanted to read
Sheikh Abu Talib, you have to speak the microphone a little closer in order to the background.
It's already screaming.
Yeah, keep it closer.
Okay. Okay. Can y'all hear me back there now?
Yes.
All right. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, MashaAllah, MashaAllah.
All right.
Thank you. This is this situation that has happened, this very tragic event, which is basically a shaitanic thing that had happened in Orlando, is something that I believe that I have to speak briefly to, mainly because I'm afraid for so many of you, in the sense that every time something like this happens, people lose their feeling for jihad. MashaAllah, it becomes a dirty word because of some patsy, some fool that thinks that murder is a tactic of jihad. And murder has never been a tactic of jihad. These people are criminals. If they were anybody else but Muslims, they would be viewed as criminals. But it is important for us to maintain what one of our most important aspects of our religion. MashaAllah. that you strive in this religion, mashallah, that you strive not just for self and for family, but you also strive to rise so you can deal with striving for your neighbors. I told Sayyid that I was only going to speak briefly about Muhammad Ali. If you speak about Muhammad Ali, you have to speak about the Lost Foundation of Islam's program. And their program, over a period of 30 years, spanned the entire nation of the United States of America. They influenced me even though I did not believe in their theology. There's no way in the world I could believe that a man is God, or that the black man is God and the white man is devil and all this kind of crazy thing. But what they had was they had an intention to lift up their people. And that intention is a very important thing, but maybe, if you all invite me back at some other time, I will speak more thoroughly about intentions, mashallah, alhamdulillah, and two basic aspects of intention. But what I want to do right now is read you a poem, alhamdulillah. All y'all know that I write poetry anyway. So I'm reading you a poem. Y'all still can hear me back there?
Yes.
Alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. And I'm going to read it slow so folks who don't know English too good can understand what I'm talking about, I hope, inshallah. The name of this poem is called The Amigo of Arrogance. Amigo means friends. The Amigo of Arrogance. Extremism, fanaticism, terrorism and veils. If you listen to the media, Islam breeds subhumans with tails, but the politics of Islam are deeper than a soundbite. They're seldom placed under scrutiny's revealing light. Islam is a universal culture, a right, complete way of life. Islam pushes peace, yet mandates violent strife when its practitioners are militarily oppressed. Islam doesn't condone murder, but when alien or domestic powers possessed by megalomaniac arrogance and greed are held bent on determined to feed upon the dignity of Muslims, their labor and lands, Islam demands that Muslims unite and take appropriate stands, opposed to aggression, tyranny, and crime. This is God's standing order in all places and time. And this is just common sense. A lack of vigilance due to philosophical incompetence makes it impossible to even conceive a gallant consequence to an oppressor's insolence. And negligence, and religion so steeped in martial indolence and negligence that it commands its people to bow before invaders, tyrants, and corruptors like Horace Sinkelfence in craven obedience, preferring safety and or economic expedience to the kind of self-determination, freedom, and other virtuous ingredients needed to hold one's head up in dignified self-defense is viewed as ignoble by almighty divine providence and unworthy by all men of honor and consequence. But when the northern world got determined to establish their rules and wed sulfur to iron to make exploding war tools, no one, nowhere, could resist their invasion. They had their way with the world through violent persuasion, killing, enslaving, without religious or moral dissuasion. Flesh against metal, swords against guns, tribes against nations who were worse than the Huns. Who will deny the Atlantic slave trade and the wound on humanity that Holocaust made? Then the white Western tyrants used fire and sword to rule most of the world in the name of the Lord. The brown Eastern tyrants were soundly defeated, yet even though Muslim war glory drastically receded, Islam still dictates how even the defeated should think and behave. Muslims are to use their common sense and not let the Muslim community become a slave to wrong-headed arrogance standing against God's way of life. Whoever rules over Muslims must expect all kinds of strife if corruption becomes strife in the Muslim community. Islam does not allow the Muslim community to apathetically give immorality immunity, to hold sway with impunity. When those who pray five times a day find the courage to speak, they'll stand up and say that Islam is the only force that can rule them. Islam is the only philosophy that can school them. Islam is the only shade that can cool them. Tranquility through submission to God is reality. No illusion will fool them. This never will change, not now and not ever. There is no ism, no science, no financial lever that will keep the devout of Islam from wanting to endeavor to establish God's kingdom on earth. Whether those who would be gods or God's partners like it or not, at the risk of being hung, knifed, or covertly shot. So though murder is evil, political organizing, self-defense, and civil disobedience is not. When faced with oppression, brave Muslims, just like everybody else, will most certainly stand up and fight. It is God's will. It is a fundamental human right. It is democratic to the max that the majority's will dominates. So where Islam is the predominant culture, the Muslim majority eventually nominates some form of Islam to be the official political philosophy of the state, shouting the most pious slogan, Allahu Akbar, Allah God Allah is Akbar. Most great. That being said, know that Islam condemns murder as wrong. Muslims were not made strong and ruled the world for so long by indiscriminately killing innocents and sowing cruelty-induced fear. In fact, Islam holds humans' lives so sacred and dear that a clear divine edict to which Muhammad strictly did adhere, killing non-combatants is forbidden, even when jihad is in high gear. That's why modern-day warfare took Muslims with ease. It's cowardly, unholy, a martial disease. Even guerrilla warfare was considered cowardly and unfair. Who would dare be unaware of whom he was killing even in warfare? To the original Muslims, modern warfare would be considered a nightmare that can only be waged by those who didn't care for their soul's eternal welfare. Dropping bombs from the air without a care as to whom such death-dealing promiscuity does not spare. Muslims on horseback fought back against mechanical warfare, but had to give up in defeat and pitiful despair, or adopt satanic tactics, the devil's psychopathic snare. Thus, everywhere that was industrially poor became dominated and humiliated, and then thoroughly miseducated by megalomaniac Machiavellians who were power inebriated. The politics of the heart became a lost art. Heartless men till this day, from the start, follow the feral though they see the sea part. From high in the sky with devices deemed conventional, promiscuous killing is termed unintentional. The fate of humanity sits on the edge of a knife because this dishonorable strife is just a symptom that wrong has grown rife. Gross, open evil caused by warped values and greed, diffused love of playthings trumps the world's desperate need. So even some Muslims believe there is no God-revealed proof, no right do's and don'ts, no absolute truth. If God didn't reveal and right is determined by how most voters feel, then there's no ultimate justice because there's no right and no wrong. And might should be worshipped for, right is not strong. If there's no heaven or hell, no angel that fell, there's no soul to sell, no damn devil's spell. If there's no right to fight for, no spiritual core, then there is no God, and with death there is forever no more. Then honor or valor won't alter the score, but those with faith in the God in heaven and hell will abide by God's edicts, won't break ranks and rebel. Those who believe that God did reveal know it's God damned to murder, to lie, cheat, and steal. If you love what is evil and hate what is right and cover the truth and hide from the light, it's damned, no matter if you're rich or you're poor, If you're weak or you're strong, wrong is wrong to wrong score. Then why do Muslims, Christians, and Jews wage conflicts that contradict our own code of ethics? Perhaps we're too focused on martial conflicts to notice the divisionary tricks of satanic politics. While souls spin out of control in each place, on each level, attention is distracted from the real plot of the devil. The real devil plots against your human soul. That's the real devil's purpose, his only real goal. With chaos-induced confusion and financial illusion, Satan murders your values and virtue till you reach life's conclusion. The real war against terror is the war against ego. Arrogance is the enemy and stupidity is amigo. Know that God sent Muhammad with a divine rhyme composition to cast light on the basic Islamic proposition that there's none to serve or to worship but the one, with no peer, no gold calf or bank book, no chief or a mirror, only God the Almighty, who's everywhere and here. And God's final prophet is a voice crystal clear that must be obeyed when hearing ears hear. And God never prescribed murder to make non-Muslims fear. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad
wa ali Muhammad.
MashaAllah.
Excellent, Shaykh. Alhamdulillah. MashaAllah. So, the thing that I want you, I'm going to put this online where, with the Dermot's Facebook page. Ali Salam will help me do
this. This video will be on YouTube soon, inshallah. The video.
Oh, how about that? Okay. Yeah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, MashaAllah, MashaAllah. So it should be easy for you to add.
There is any part that we need to call?
No, everything's cool. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. No need to edit anything. Okay. MashaAllah, MashaAllah. No. I just want you to recognize that the shaitan, ever since you've been here, and most of you have been here for 20, 30 years, the shaitan has tried to get you to see everything as them versus us. You know, I mean, when I first became a Muslim, people thought that it was amazing because a lot of people thought that you had to be born in a Muslim family to become Muslim. But this is not true. And for people who believe like we do, that believe in the faith of Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salam, Fatima Zahra, alayhi salam, mashallah, and their family, mashallah, Big Prophet being the head of it, mashallah, and Jibril being an honorary member of it. We are the ones that if we are not afraid, if we understand about the jihad of the soul, that means when you're trying to compete for other people's souls, then it is possible that we can rise, mashallah, right here in this place, right now, right here. So that in time, maybe not today or tomorrow, but how about in 4 or 5 years if we try? That we can rise to help our neighbors, mashallah, like Muhammad Ali did, only much more succinct, how can I say succinct? Much more focused and centered, mashallah. I mean, each one teach 2, 3. If you're in school, you can teach 2, 3, maybe 10, alhamdulillah. If you are conversant in what you believe in, and you're not only talking the talk, but you walk the walk. In order to do that, you have to have real intentions. And if you invite me back, I will talk to you about those intentions. Right now, I want to turn this microphone back over to my brother here so we can further talk about what happened in Orlando, because many people has asked him to speak on this, alhamdulillah, brother, and I think it's important that a young person does. All right? So what?
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
So I think that everyone here and every logical individual already knows that we condemn murder. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time saying that, you know, we condemn this action, because it's obvious. No reasonable person will ever accept somebody to do such an action. But what I want to talk about is the outcome of this action and how it's going to affect all of us and how we need to approach what's happening here. First, I want you to understand that the media in general is not your friend. And look what Allah mentions to you in the Quran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu in ja'akum fasiqun bin-naba'in fatabayyanu. If somebody comes to you, they're not trustworthy with news, verify it. We're hearing so many things, people jumping to so many conclusions on the media. And we don't need to jump to conclusions ourselves. And I just want to give an example here about something that happened with the media relating to this event that affects our community specifically. Specifically our community. How many of you remember Dr. Farooq Sikaleshvar? Our dear brother, our dear Sheikh, Dr. Farooq, who came here, I believe twice we've had him as a speaker. He gave a lecture 3 years ago at the University of Michigan on the subject of Islam's stance on homosexuality. And as you know, the shooting that happened was at a homosexual nightclub. And the shooter is allegedly a Muslim.
ISIS.
Whatever he is, I don't know. His brother said ISIS. I don't know what he is. He's an idiot. That's what he is.
Not a fool. Not Muslim.
Not Muslim. And ISIS has nothing to do with Islam. Anyway, our dear brother, Dr. Farooq, gave a lecture 3 years ago at the University of Michigan about the issue of homosexuality in Islam. They took his words, and many of you have met Dr. Farooq. He's the nicest, most humble person you'll ever meet. And he's never threatened anybody. They took his words, they twisted it, they said Dr. Farooq is telling people that you need to kill gays. That you need to go and kill all the homosexuals. And they brought this, they took one sentence from his lecture, one sentence. 30 seconds. He was speaking about the actual Islamic laws. And he was explaining them and saying, do they apply now, do they not apply now, what's going on? They took one sentence from his lecture, they put it on the news, and they said, oh, here, this individual is inciting people to kill homosexuals. And now it's all over the news, and our dear Sheikh is receiving death threats.
Is it television?
On television. They had it on local TV in Florida, and now it's all over newspapers, even very large newspapers like the Telegraph in the UK is running the story. So it's something to think about, how the media twists things. Now you're hearing all different types of things. The issue in America is, you know, the problem is with Muslims. The problem is with gun control. The problem with I don't know what. It's ridiculous. The whole thing is ridiculous. The problem we have is one crazy individual went out and killed a bunch of people. That's the problem. There's nothing else to the story. It's not that complicated. But you're going to see people want to spin it, and they want to use it for political gains. And it's important for all of us to keep that in mind and be very, very careful with this. And the other thing is that you as Muslims, you have a right. You have rights in this country. And one of your rights is freedom of speech. And you have the right of freedom of religion. And I saw, unfortunately, many people. Okay, so killing people, innocent people, in this situation is wrong. Obviously. But that just because this happened doesn't mean that we have to change our stance on homosexuality. We as Muslims believe that this is something that we don't agree with. This is not acceptable to us. Could somebody turn off the echo, please? Thank you.
It's because of the side effect of your words.
No, it's just difficult. I hear my own echo and it's like hard for me to focus on my speaking. Thank you. So then there's no need for us to say, okay, now we're accepting homosexuality. That's,
you have every right in this country to express your opinion in a reasonable and civilized manner. And nobody has, no Muslim in America is calling to kill anybody.
It's okay.
Absolutely not. And so you have to keep this in mind. Don't let fear take you. This is shaitan. And we have hadith about that. That cowardice and fear is shadow of shaitan. So that concludes all I really have to say about this subject. So I'm going to turn the microphone back to my brother here. Sallallahu alayhi wa Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
There's not much else to speak on that level right now, mashallah. The only thing that I'm really hoping for is that, once again, that you do what my brother says and you learn how not to trust this media. If you knew what I know, you'd be thinking very, very carefully, how in the world that this one guy in a gangster-ridden place like Orlando, Florida, with a bunch of Cuban gays up in there, probably many of them armed and dangerous, shot 50 people with a Glock. Number one. Number two, why is it, how could it possibly be of just a mere coincidence that this happens right after the Muslims get the best PR that they've ever had since Muhammad Ali was fighting?
Yeah.
MashaAllah. All of a sudden now, all of this is erased behind the shooting. Coincidence. Possibly, shaitan is real. It's possible. But it's also possibly an engineered thing. And I wouldn't just say it's government, because the government is not a monolith. In other words, everybody in the government doesn't believe the same thing. There are cells within the government that would do something like this, believe me. And there are cells outside the government that would do something like this, especially amongst the Yahuda, especially, because they have the most gain from this. So think very, very seriously before you start trusting the media, mashallah. Like he said, you have rights in this country, and you have rights that are just human rights. You have the right to think, mashallah. And not only do you have a right to think, but you have an obligation to think. So think very, 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 very strongly. Whatever you hear in the media, mashallah, that it may be right, it may be not, you don't really know, mashallah, until we get some definitive proof. And oftentimes we never get the definitive proof, especially in situations like this, mashallah. So the thing that I'm hoping for and praying for, that our brothers and sisters here in San Diego really, really take this time of Ramadan to pray to Allah to rise up and be a part of the Mu'min movement, not just the Muslim movement, the Mu'min movement, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen, that must take place here in the United States of America, mashallah, because our neighbors, our friends, our classmates, the people that we work with, they do not even realize that the final prophet has come and gone. MashaAllah. They don't know. This is the real jihad here. We're fighting for the hearts and souls of men. MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. We have people that are fighting with bullets over there. That's not our thing right here, right now. Our thing is to rise up so that we have enough knowledge and enough courage, MashaAllah, so that we can export our faith, not just our religion, our faith and our discipline, which we sorely lack at this particular point, mashallah, that we have to rise in discipline so that we can represent the household of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. I want to close with a prayer, which is also a poem, mashallah, but it's taken from one of the prayers of Imam Zain al-Abidin. It would be long, so I shorten it to make it very, very short, inshallah. Not very, very short, but shorter than it would be. Can y'all hear me back there?
Yeah.
Yes. Sure?
Yes.
Okay. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Now,
remember, this is a dua, not just a poem, so don't be afraid to say Amin.
Okay.
We take refuge with Allah from the Satan, the stoned. Harbor us, Lord, for be you what we are owned. O Allah, bless Muhammad's soul and rain down peace on his household. For your light shines brightest near Muhammad's vast soul, and its meaning refracts clearly through his household's chaste robe. In name of Allah, the source of mercy to all of creation, the source of the mercy to the faithful congregation. O Allah, bless those who assist and support the true movement.
Amen.
Gaining from their guides divine guidance towards spiritual improvement.
Amen.
Seeing with them, agreeing with them, never accusing them, accepting their guidance, not refusing them, not thinking right guidance was abusing them, rather realizing that their actions and their words was infusing them with the realization that it was you, Lord, that was choosing them. O Allah, bless those who follow in the movement's blessed wake, from the present till the day the death will awake. Bless us and our offspring and our dutiful mates and our comrades who obey every one of your soul-saving dictates. Bless us with the blessing so our soul never deviates, and reserve a nice place for those committed to this true movement in your garden of bliss. Make us immune to Satan's tricks, which makes folks fail to resist, fail, fall, not rise, aim poorly and miss. And when we seek your help in your service, give us your aid. Protect us from the unexpected so we won't be afraid. Protect us from surprises that come in the night or the day, except those unforeseen, auspicious events on the grace-filled straight way. Inculcate in the followers of the leaders of the true movement the virtue of hope. Tie it round our characters like a mountain climber's rope, so we'll ascend safely to desire for that which is with you, and not fall into trusting what's foolish, wrong, and wickedly untrue. Don't let us let go to go after and grasp what others hold dear. Restore shaky convictions with God-conscious fear. Inspire us to renounce the path of spiritually precarious sense gratification for a firm spiritual foothold on God's final divine revelation. Help us to march forward and climb upward on the path of everlasting glorification, prophetically forewarned of what comes after our body's worldly annihilation. Make life's journey easier to navigate towards the most auspicious final destination by the mercy of your compassionate divine authorization of our souls prayed for undeserved ultimate sanctification. O Allah, relieve the true movement people from all anxiety and stress just before passing into the grave to take the final test as the soul struggles to leave the body to be God-damned in stress or to enjoy its God-blessed best rest. O Allah, at that time release us from all inclinations that causes one's faith to wane. Cause us to banish all doubt and zikr and pray through the pain. Dispel the Satan's last-ditch efforts to conjure a spell to compel us to that which would expel your favorites pell-mell and propel us to the everlasting fires of hell. Rather, escort us to the secure abode where your Prophet Muhammad's blessed followers forever farewell. O Allah, bless Muhammad's soul and rain down peace on his household. For your light shines brightest near Muhammad's vast soul, and its meaning reflects clearly through his household's chaste robe. Surely God's greatness defies all attempts at description, and to attempt so can merit just foul, foolish fiction. Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar.
So please, y'all, this night and every night, if you possibly can, wake up for tahajjud. This is the time to get ready for the night, Laylatul Qadr. MashaAllah, Alhamdulillah.
MashaAllah,
Ahsan. MashaAllah. So if you don't have the habit, set your clock. You just go to work a little sneaky, it won't fire you. It's only a month. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. MashaAllah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. جهت قبولی طاعات عبادتتون، روزه ها و نمازهاتون، صلواتی جری خط بفرمایید.
اللهم صل على محمد و آل محمد.
I just want to spend five minutes to talk together inshallah about the Quran interpretation. First I have to thank Sheikh Abu Talib because of his beautiful poems, especially more powerful than speech is the power of poem. It is more stable and more effective. MashaAllah, this is a ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted to you, Shaykh. We appreciate it. بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم قال الله الحکیم فی القرآن الكریم و من جاهد فإنما یجاهد لنفسه ان الله لغنی عن العالمین. فرا برادرهای بزرگوار، تفسیر سوره مبارکه عنکبوت به آیه ششم رسیدیم با هم، جایی که خدای مهربان می‌فرماید هر کس در راه خدا جهاد کند. فإنما یجاهد لنفسه، در واقع جهاد می‌کنند برای خودش. حالا چطور این آیه شریفه در یک چنین روزی آمد که هر کس جهاد بکند؟ شیخ ابو طالب هم مقداری گفتن راجع به جهاد. این کلمه مقدس جهاد متأسفانه امروزه چقدر 100% به معنای غلط برداشته شده، در حالی که همونطور که استحضار دارید کلمه جهاد از جهد میاد. جهد یعنی زحمت کشیدن. بعد از ایمان نوبت به جهد و زحمت کشیدن می شود. زمانی که شما به زبان قبول کردید اعتقادات دین رو، نوبت می رسه به عمل. عملش چیه؟ سخت است که عشق آسان نمود اول، ولی افتاده مشکلها. اول وقتی که انسان ایمان رو قبول میکنه، بعد میبینه که خب این تنها قول لا اله الا الله تفلحا نیست، نماز هم باید، روزه هم باید، حج هم باید، خمس هم باید، یک عالمه کار است. لذا این معنای جهاد هست. یک روایت خیلی زیبایی هست عزیزان پیامبر مکرم اسلام حضرت محمد مصطفی صلی الله علیه و آله و سلم درباره جهاد یک تعبیر خیلی زیبایی میکنند. فلما رجعوا قال مرحبا بقوم قضوا الجهاد الاصغر وبغى الجهاد الاكبر. اصحاب پیغمبر خدا از جنگ برگشتند، خسته، زخمی، تشنه، گرسنه، بیخواب. پیغمبر خدا فرمودند خوش آمدید، مرحبا به شما قومی که، به شما ملتی که از جنگ کوچک آمدید. یا رسول الله، فلانی کشته شد، کجاش جنگ کوچیک بود، فلانی پاش از دست رفت، فلانی دستش از فلانی سه شب نخوابید، باید تشنگی گرسنگی، آخرین باری که آب خوردید نمیدونیم که این هست. شما میفهمید جهاد اصغره، این جهاد کوچیک هست. پیامبر خدا فرمودن که قیل یا رسول الله و من جهاد الاکبر، پس جنگ بزرگ چیه؟ خدا اونو بخیر بکنه یا رسول الله. فرمودن قال جهاد نفس، جنگ با خود، این بزرگترین جهاد هست. این رسول الله بعث سریتن و بقا علیهم الجهاد الاکبر. در جای دیگه روایت خیلی قشنگی هست، می فرماین که ایما عبد اطاعنی لم الکه الى غیری و ایما عبد عصانی و کلته الى نفسه ثم لم ابال فی ای و ادلها. خواهر، برادر، بزرگترین دشمنی که ما باید باش بجنگیم این نفس اماره ما هست. اگر جایی که نفس چیزی میخواهد گفتی نه، شما در جهاد اکبر پیروز شدید. این جهاد هست در نزد اسلام، نه اینکه یک شخصی بره یک عده مظلوم بیگناه رو در هر جایی از دنیا شروع بکنه به کشتن. او جهاد نیست در نزد اسلام. تو نمیدونم از کجا آمده، کی براشون اینا رو دیکته کرده، نه این نیست. جهاد اکبر نزد پیامبر مکرم اسلام این است.
ای شها کشتیم ما خصم برون، زان بتر خصمی بود اندر درون. کشتن آن کار عقل و هوش نیست، شیر باطن سخره خرگوش نیست. شیر آن نیست آن که صفها بشکند، نه اون نیست شیر. شیر آن دان آن که خود را بشکند، هر که به نفس اماره خود گفت نه. شمایی که روزه گرفتید شما تونستید نبگید، شمایی که آمدید مسجد حالا موقع خواب خیلی دارن استراحت میکنن، شما تونستید به نفس اماره خود نبگید. شمایی که پول شیرینه، برای این پول زحمت کشیدی پیداش کردی، حالا این پول رو در میاری اینجا اسمت رو میبیسی در زمره افتاب دهندگان، این مقدسه، اینا جهاده. شمایی که وقت میذاری نیم ساعت یک ساعت با جوان خودت صحبت میکنی، زبان روزدار، تا این جوان رو از اون احساسات و خیالات جوانیش بیاری پایین، از اون پیر پرشری که داره از اون خارجش بکنی و تشویقش بکنی بیاد مسجد، این جهاده. اگر در طول سی روز ماه رمضان یک جوانی که اهل مسجد نیست، شما تونیستی دستشو بگیری بیاری توی مسجد، از ثواب جنگ احد و خندق هم ثوابش بیشتر نزد پیغمبر خدا. به گردن من به شما قول میدم، اینا جهاد هست خواهر برادر. حالا زیباتر اینه، خدای مهربان میفرماید فانما یجاهد لنفسه، هر کس در راه خدا زحمتی میکشد، کوششی میکند، برای من نیست، برای من خدا نیست. اگر روزه میگیری برای من خدا نیست، اگر در راه خدا انفاق میکنی برای من خدا نیست. من نه پول شما بندگان رو میخوام، من خدا نه نماز شما رو احتیاج دارم، من خدا نه به حج شما احتیاج دارم، نه. فانما یجاهد لنفسه، هر کار خیری که میکنی زحمت میکشی برای خودته، برای خودت داری سیو میکنی، برای خودت داری خرج میکنی، برای خودت میماند. اگر جرأت میکنی همینطور که شیخ ابو طالب گفتن نیمه شب بلند میشی دو رکعت نماز شب میخوانی، روح خودت رو بلند میکنی، برای خودته. این روزه که میگیری برای خودت هست، وقت میذاری، صبر میکنی، به پای جوانت اون رو توضیح میدی، هی اون داره خودش رو در میره، هی بهت یک حرف تندی میزنه، برو بابا مسجد چیه، برو بابا قرآن چیه، و هی شما داری خشم خودت رو کنترل میکنی، با صبر و حوصله دعوتش میکنی، میاریش، این ثواب داره. و خیرش رو کی میبره؟ اول خیرش رو خودت میبری. فانما یجاهد لنفسه، چقدر زیباست این آیه، دوباره میخونم، و من جاهده، هر که زحمت میکشه، فانما یجاهد لنفسه، برای خودش زحمت میکشه. اون کسی که در راه خدا یک وقتی یک پول بزرگی داده و بعد حالا یا خانومش یا شوهرش یا همسرش یا فامیلش یا رفیقش پشیمانش کرده، این جنای انسی بهش گفته که حالا چرا این پول رو داری؟ حیف شد، تو زحمت کشیدی. اما وقتی که میمیرد، همون پولی که در راه خدا هست که به دردش میخوره، اون پولهایی که اینجا گذاشته برای ورثه به دردش نمیخوره. و من جاهده فانما یجاهدو، بگی لنفسه، جا داره اون داستان رو تکرار کنم. پیامبر خدا گوسفندی رو قربانی کردن، همسرشون همه رو به در همسایه تقسیم کرد، آمدن سوال کردن خانم چی مونده؟ گفت یا رسول الله فقط شانش مونده. پیغمبر خدا فرمودن نه، این شانه ای رو که نگه داشتی، شانه گوسفند رو که ما بخوریم، این نمانده، هر چه در راه خدا انفاق کردی مانده. ان الله لغنی عن العالمین، بلا فاصله خداوند میفرماید، آیه رو کامل میکنه با این جمله فوق العاده تکان دهنده و جان بخش، ان الله لغنی عن العالمین، من خدا همانا به درستی که بی‌نیاز هستم از بندگان خودم. اگر تمام همه عالم روزه و نماز و خیرات و صدقات رو ترک بکنم، گردی بر دامن کبریای من خدا نمی‌نشینه. همه اینها برای اینه که شما رو رشد بدین. اگر اون همه رول و رگولیشنی که یک اسکول، یک مدرسه برای بچه‌ها می‌گذارن، برای این نیست که یک چیزی یه خیلی به معلم و مدیر مدرسه برسه، نه، برای اینکه بچه‌ها رشد بکنن. خدایا با آبروی محمد و آل محمد در این شبهای عزیز نورانی و قرآنی، قلم مهربان عفوت رو بر گناهانمون بکشان. فرج مولامون امام زمانمون معجل بفرما، حوائجمون برآورده به خیر بفرما، پروردگارا به اسلام به مسلمین عزت عطا بفرما، خدایا کید کفار منافقین به خودشون برگردان، عاقبت امر همه ما ختم به خیر بفرما، صلح و آرامش رو در همه جای عالم برقرار بفرما، اموات جمع حاضرین، اموات بانیان افطار، بانیان خیر، غریق دریای رحمت بفرما، رحم الله لمن یقرا الفاتحه مع الاخلاص و الصلوات. اللهم صل على محمد و آل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم. الحمد لله رب العالمین.